In this series, we'll be covering MEL scripting in MayaLT. Over the course of these videos, we'll be writing three useful shelf scripts which you can use to create a variety of interesting objects and environments. Our first script will help us create instances of an object on a set of selected vertices. Our second script will help us create and align instances to a set of selected faces. Our third script will help us create NURBS curve controllers to facilitate posing and animation. Let's start by covering the basics of MEL. Open the script editor by clicking on the bottom right icon. You can also embed the script editor as a panel by right-clicking and selecting the script editor perspective layout. Most actions you perform in Maya are bound to specific MEL commands which are echoed in the editor's history. To produce the same cylinder, copy the polycylinder MEL command into the bottom tab. Highlight the command and press the Execute button or hit Ctrl-Enter. This creates a new cylinder with the same dimensions as the previous one. Let's use the Move command to reposition it. The R flag moves the object relative to its current position instead of placing it at a set of absolute coordinates. In most cases, when we don't specify an object's name as the last argument, the command will operate on the user's current selection. As you work in Maya, you'll encounter a variety of different commands. If you want to learn more about a specific command, open the online help and navigate to the MEL commands reference page. There, you'll find a comprehensive list of all the MEL commands. If we search for polycylinder, we can learn more about its flags. In this case, the CH flag enables construction history. The O flag creates the cylinder in the scene instead of only in the dependency graph. The R flag determines the cylinder's radius, while the H flag determines its height. The SC flag controls the number of subdivisions on the cylinder's cap. This is equivalent to the SZ flag. Finally, the CUV flag controls the way in which the primitive's UVs are created. In addition to MEL commands, you can find a list of helper functions for vectors, arrays, trigonometry, and random number generation under the Help Guides scripting section. So far, we've seen how to quickly reuse commands to repeat simple operations. Let's dig a bit deeper to create our first shelf script, which will generate instances of an object on a set of selected vertices. First, replace the contents of the bottom tab with a pair of curly brackets. Any variables and functions we declare within these brackets will stay confined to this scope. In other words, we won't risk overwriting any global variables or functions created by other scripts. Let's create a variable within this scope to store the user's current selection. We've named our variable selection to properly identify it, but we could have used any other word. Variable names in MEL must start with the dollar sign character. In addition, every statement must end with a semicolon. The string keyword denotes the variable's type. The string type indicates that this variable will store text. Other variable types exist, including int for whole numbers, float for decimal numbers, vector and matrix. Boolean values are represented by integers, 0 for false and 1 for true. You can use the true and false or on and off keywords instead to make your code more readable. The square brackets at the end of the variable name indicate that this variable will actually store an array of strings. We're using an array here because the user's current selection can contain more than one object. Now, to assign the user's current selection to our variable, we'll use the ls command along with the sl flag inside a pair of back quotes. The ls command normally returns the names of all the objects in the scene. However, the sl flag makes sure the command only returns objects that have been selected. Contrary to our call to polycylinder, the back quotes are necessary here because we want to store the result of the ls command inside a variable. You can condense the variable's declaration along with its assignment to reduce the number of lines in your script. Let's add a print statement to output the selected object's names. We'll test our script out on the two cylinders in the scene. The cylinder's names are printed in the editor, so we know our script is working. The user's selection can store a variety of different objects and components. To show this, first select a whole cylinder, and then enter vertex selection mode to select some vertices on the second cylinder. When we run the script, the name of the first cylinder object is printed, as well as the names of the selected vertices. The contents of the square brackets represent intervals of vertex names. We can modify our call to the ls command with the fl flag to flatten the vertex intervals. This way, each vertex name occupies its own entry in the selection array. Despite this flattened structure, the cylinder object's name and the vertex names still exist in the same array. Let's use the filter expand command to filter the vertex names into their own array. The selection mask flag determines what we're filtering for. We'll use the value of 31, which filters for vertices. You can use a value of 32 to filter for edges, or 34 to filter for faces. The complete list of these values can be found in the filter expand command reference. The expand flag behaves similarly to the FL flag for the LS command. It ensures each vertex name is individually listed instead of appearing as intervals. Let's also modify our print statement to print the current array of vertex names. When we run this script again, the name of each vertex is properly printed to the script editor, since we're only printing the contents of the vertex names array. Now that we've stored the selected vertices in the vertex names variable, let's identify the object we'll be instancing. We want our tool to create instances of the first object in the selection. To make sure the ls command returns the objects in the same order they were selected, replace the sl flag with the os flag for ordered selection. In MEL, arrays use zero-based indexing, so the first element in the selection will be at index 0. Note that the object-to-instance variable is not declared with square brackets. In this case, we only want to store a single string instead of an array of strings, so we can omit the square brackets. Now, for instancing to work, we need to check that this object's type is a transform. We'll explain how object types relate to the scene graph in the next part of this tutorial. For now, write the following if-else statement, which compares the result of the object type command to the transform string. If the object's type is not a transform, we'll print an error message before exiting the script. Let's also take this time to comment our previous print statement out using two forward slashes. You could also use a slash and a star to begin a multi-line comment. Within the body of our if statement, create a for-in loop to iterate over all the selected vertices. For each vertex, we'll use the instance command to create a new instance of the object. Use the point position command along with the W flag to return the world space coordinates of the current vertex. We'll store these coordinates in the position variable. Next, we'll move the new instance in absolute world space coordinates to the point's position. To test our script, create a sphere in the scene and select it. Enter vertex mode and hold shift while you select the cylinder's vertices. When you run the script, new instances of the sphere are created at the same position as each vertex in the selection. As a final step, add this script to your shelf so you can run it with a simple mouse click. If you prefer to keep your scripts in one spot, create a new shelf and name it My Tools. Save your script as vinst, short for vertex instances. You can also save this script to your file system as vertexinstances.mel. With this tool, the instances you create are only positioned at the selected vertices. However, their orientation remains unchanged with respect to the target mesh's normals. In the next part, we'll look at how we can use a bit of math to properly orient our instances to a set of selected faces.